Good afternoon and good everyone. So today I'll be teaching you Stray's first chapter, that is tracing the change through 1,000 years. So this is very first chapter of history. So far you already have studied ancient history till class 6th, and now we'll be moving on to the medieval history. Tracing the changes through 1,000 years is one of the chapters where we are going to study about changes or the transformation that has taken place from the period of 750 to 1750. And we are also going to study about the changes there are many types of changes, like changes in the terminology, changes in the maps that we study, changes in the social structure, changes in the political structure, technological changes. It is no very, very obvious. So if I talk about a transformation that is taking place for 1,000 years from now, then definitely it is going to be a different world from today. In the same way, the changes which have taken place from the in the medieval time period has shown a major shift in 1,000 years. If I take an example, if I talk about our city, Varanasi, then definitely what it was 20 years back from now. And when we compare your own city from 20 years back from now and to the present day, then definitely it has shown a lot. It has shown a drastic change in our own city in terms of facilities that are provided, in terms of the political structure, in terms of the social structure. So it has changed within the time span of 20 years. So definitely when we are talking about 1,000 year shift in time span, then it could be a major transformation or a major shift that has taken over. So before I share you my screen, you should be ready with your notebooks and your pen so that you can jot down the important points. And later on when you revise, you are able to go with the flow of the text that you're reading. So I'm sharing my screen. Okay. First of all, as I've already told you that so many changes have taken place. So first we'll be talking about the changes that have taken place in the maps. First of all, you must be knowing the term cartographer. Cartographer is a person who creates or who makes map. Whereas a cartography is the study of or a practice of making maps. Okay. So we are going to study about the two images in chapter 1 on the very first page that you're going to visit of your textbook. If you'll see, you'll find it. Here is map 1 and map 2. Image 1 is for map 1 and image 2, which is for map 2. When we see the maps in image 1 and image 2, first of all, the thing is coming that in image 1, what has been given, because it is not at all familiar to us. Whereas image 2, we are somewhere able to locate it, our own structure of Indian map. So we do find that in image 1, you can see that image 1, we'll be considering image 1 as map 1 and image 2 as map 2. Okay. So in image 1, can you see Sri Lanka, which is found to be in image 2 bottom side, it is found at the upward location. And we find that which is the place which is existing in north side, it is found to be in southern part of India, whereas the southern part of India where we usually locate Sri Lanka is in the northern part of India. So we can see that image 1 or map 1 is being tilted towards upside down to the present map, whereas when we see this particular map 2, that is image 2, we see that it is somewhat very, very similar to our present day map, because the places of North India, because the map is into the same position, we do locate North India in the north side and the South India in the southernmost part, because Sri Lanka is being at the southern part of India. Okay, so, and there are many shifts apart from the tilt of map. We can see that the places or the languages which have been marked in image one is not at all familiar to us, because it's written in Arabic. And this map one has been made by an Arab geographer whose name was Al-Idrisi. He made the map somewhere in 1154 CE, whereas map two, we can see that the places are marked in French, because this particular map was constructed by a French cartographer. And since he was a French cartographer, definitely he must be, the most familiar language to him would be French. So definitely the places are marked in English and French. Although when we see about the next thing, that is, this map was made somewhere in 1720s. So a major shift, almost 600 years after image map 2 was created, before map, after map 1. Okay, so I hope now you are able to connect to the differences that I've told you. The very first is that the southern part of India is located in the northern part of India, and the northern part would be in southern part of India. Whereas in map 2, we find exactly the north part is in the north part and the south part in the southern part. It was made by an Arab geographer whose name was Al-Idrisi, and it was made by a French cartographer. Okay. Then when we talk about the third point of difference, we can say that this map, the places of this map are marked in Arabic, whereas it is marked in French in map 2. The fourth difference we can notice is what? This particular map has been constructed by Al-Idrisi, and this has been constructed by a French cartographer. Okay, moving on to the next slide. Okay, now we are going to talk about changes or the meanings of terms changed over a period of time. Because if we talk about, there have been a lot of changes in terminologies, in the words that we use today was very different in the past. Although the words may be similar, but the meaning has changed over a period of time. For example, if I take you to the term Hindustan. Hindustan, before I proceed with the meaning, I will share one video with you. Kindly go through it.
India, Bharat, Bharata, Bharatvarsh, Aryabheta, Tianchu, and almost a gazillion other tongue-twisting names for just one nation. Of course, each of these names comes with its own historical baggage and controversy. But perhaps there's none as controversial as the name Hindustan. How many times have you heard someone say, if India is a secular country, why is it called Hindustan? Well, for a start, Hindustan is not the official name for India. It is India or Bharata. And even if you still feel it is unfair to even call India Hindustan, because Hindustan obviously is the combination of the words Hindu and Stan, and therefore means land of followers of Hinduism. Well, know what? That's not completely true. Explanation time. Come with me to a time long, long ago. The river Indus or Sindhu was worshipped as a mother, and every person who entered India from the northwestern side was introduced to this river. Now, this was also a time when Indian trade was flourishing. The Persians who came to India had heard of the fabled Sindhu River, except that when they pronounced it, they dropped the S and called the river Hindu. The land where Sindhu flowed and beyond was called as Hindustan. And the folks living here
got associated with the religion much, much later, close to 18th century. There was no religion called Hinduism back then. When someone was speaking of Hindustan, they were speaking of the place by Indus and not of the place belonging to folks following Hinduism. Hindu broadly meant every Indian and didn't imply the religion. Incidentally, our country gets its name India also from the river Indus, And also, incidentally, most of the river Indus, from which we get the names India and Hindustan, now belongs to our brothers in Pakistan. Whew, guess that's enough gyan for today.
Okay, so moving on to the word Hindustan, you must have got a glimpse that what we are going to talk about. Hindustan, as I already shared you, if somebody will say that, what do you mean by the term Hindustan? Definitely, we are going to include the entire subcontinent or the entire geographical boundaries of our country. But then, in the past, it doesn't meant in the same way, because the people often have given their own opinion regarding the term Hindustan, because whenever we go into, when we are going to talk about a chronicler, he is going to he might have thought in a different way. When you're going to talk about a ruler, his perception of the term Hindustan has a different meaning to the term, whereas a poet might have thought in the different way. So because the people who traveled in India have given their own opinion regarding the term Hindustan, and they meant in their own way. But today, when we talk about the term Hindustan, we are going to include the entire part of India, which does not have the same existence in the past, because according to one of the chroniclers, that is Minhaj Siraj, he was one of the persons who visited India in the 13th century, and he only meant that according to the term Hindustan, in his context or in his perception, the Hindustan meant only the areas which are falling between the rivers Ganga and Yamuna, including Punjab and Haryana. So this, according to him, only meant the regions of Hindustan. Whereas according to the ruler Babur, who is Babur? I hope you all know. But I'm going, Babur was the founder of the Mughal Empire in India, and he fought the first battle of Panipat. You must have heard about it. In 1526, he fought first battle of Panipat, and then he captured Delhi and Agra, and that is how he laid the foundation of Mughal Empire in India. Okay, so Babur has a different meaning to the term Hindustan. He exclusively included the flora and fauna of the area, and that is what he meant by the term Hindustan. Although a poet, Amir Khusro, he is one of the very, very famous poet, and you must have heard about him. Amir Khusro, in the 16th century, his opinion was somewhere very, very similar to the ruler Babur, because he often described in the same way what Babur meant, that is the flora and fauna of the subcontinent. So moving on to the next slide, not only the term Hindustan has meant differently, but there are many other words. One is examples, foreigner. If we ask anyone that what do you mean by a foreigner, definitely in today's time he will say that anyone who is not a part of our own country. Say for example, a person traveling from US to India, definitely in India he'll be considered as a foreigner, because he does not belong to our own country. Whereas in past, the term foreigner does not meant the same, because foreigner was considered any person who is not familiar to the part, who is not familiar to the culture of the society, plus anyone who is a stranger was considered as foreigner. For example, anyone traveling from another rural area to a different area in the same village was considered to be a foreigner, because he was new to the society. But in the present time, it has taken a huge shift, because now we do not associate with regions, but we are neither bound to the states, but we are spread across the country. So we mean anyone in today's time, anyone will be considered as a foreigner if he does not belong to our own country. Okay, so I hope you might be clear with these points. Kindly do the worksheet which has been enclosed to it. And thank you so much. We'll discuss the next topic in the next video.